حامل القرآن قد خصك الرحمن بالفضل والتيجان والروح والريحان. يا حامل القرآن قد خصك الرحمن بالفضل والتيجان.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حتى أتاه اليقين، فجزاه الله عنا خير ما جزى نبيا عن أمته ورسولا عن قومه. ثم أما بعد عباد الله، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي رسول الله، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار عياذا بالله. وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. أيها المؤمنون، لقد اصطفى الله سبحانه وتعالى هذه الأمة المباركة فأرسل فيها خير رسله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأنزل إليها خير كتبه، وهداها إلى أفضل شريعة، وجعلها أمة شاهدة على الناس تأمر بالمعروف وتنهى عن المنكر، وجعلها الأمة الخاتمة التي تبعث يوم القيامة وأتباعها هم أكثر الخلق يتبعون محمدًا صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى حوضه ثم إلى جنات النعيم. وإن الله سبحانه وتعالى قد اختص هذه الأمة بجيل من أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، فجعلهم مصابيح الدجى تستضيء بهم الأمة إلى يوم القيامة. بسيرتهم نهتدي، وبآثارهم نقتفي، وببركة فضلهم نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يثبتنا على دربهم. وإن من أقرب أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إليه وأعلمهم بسيرته زوجاته أمهات المؤمنين اللواتي اختارهن الله سبحانه وتعالى واحدة واحدة، فما كان للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يتزوج امرأة إلا بأمر من الله تعالى، كما قال على سبيل المثال عن زينب رضي الله عنها زوجناكها. فأمهات المؤمنين هن قدوات لهذه الأمة، ليس فقط لنسائها، نعم هن قدوات لنساء المؤمنين بل وللرجال أيضا. فبعلمهن نهتدي ومن أحاديثهن نرتوي، فقد رأينا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في كل أحواله، في حزنه وفي غضبه وفي فرحته وفي عبادته وفي خاصة نفسه. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يرزقنا حب أمهات المؤمنين وأن يجمعنا بهن في الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected this nation to be the best of nations and to be the last of them, and Allah selected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the messenger of this nation, and the Quran to be the guide of this nation. Also, Allah selected the companions of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the role models, the heroes of this nation. We follow them and we look at them to learn from their lives. They are the ones who lived with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are the ones who implemented the Quran in their societies, in their affairs, all of them. So when we look at the life of the companions of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we see that generation, we can easily understand this generation is unique. It's not going to be repeated. That generation that Allah selected to be the role model, to be the example that we should follow. And from that generation, Allah Azza wa Jal selected the wives of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to teach us about the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of it, the private and the public. They are the ones who saw Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his bed and his bathroom, and when he was eating, and when he was sad, and he was, and when he was happy, and in all affairs. And they honestly and sincerely reported all of that, and they passed all of that over to this nation so they can follow their messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today I'm going to talk about one of them, one of the wives of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But let's go back in history, 24 years before the hijrah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That even before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became a prophet. In that year, Hind al-Makhzumiyya was born. She was from Quraysh. And soon, when she was still young, she got married. She got married to another nobleman from the same tribe, from Quraysh. He's the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdullah ibn Asad al-Makhzumi. When Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with the message of the truth, she and her husband followed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when she was about 11 years old. Soon after that, the torture and persecution of Quraysh started, and it got worse and worse. And the people of Mecca, the Muslims there, found it very difficult, particular for this young couple who were challenging their community, the entire society of injustice. They challenged that. Imagine that a young woman, age of 11 or 12, and her husband, who just a few years older than her, and they are challenging their parents, their cousins, their uncles, and everyone in society, because they made the decision to say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. She was mature enough and her husband to make that important decision, knowing that, making that decision and selecting this path will require sacrifice. Not small sacrifice, not a few coins in your pockets, not a few minutes at the end of your weekend. It will require the sacrifice of life, the sacrifice of everything from top to toe. They said, La ilaha illallah. Knowing that, by saying this, they are declaring that Allah is the owner of themselves. And from that point, they own nothing in themselves. They all belong to Allah Azza wa Jal. Hind and her husband, when the persecution intensified and the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave them permission to leave, to go to Abyssinia, they made that decision and they left. Secretly, they took that dangerous journey. Newly married couples, young, they made that decision to go in this dangerous journey to cross the sea to another country that spoke a different language, that believes in a different religion, that's different to their religion and their tribe's religion. Different cultures, different land altogether. And they went there because our Rasul advised them. He said, go to that land because the king there is fair, is the just man. And there you will be able to settle and you will be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in peace. Her first son was born over there, Salama. Soon after, false news came to them that Quraysh had become Muslim and the situation in Mecca is wonderful. And the Muslims there under Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam are practicing freely and so on and so forth. Of course, there was no reason for them to face what they had to face over there. They made the journey back to Mecca to be shocked. The situation was actually much worse than when they had left it. They continued with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Two young newly married people with their newly born son, and they continued with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, supporting and spreading the light of Allah Azza wa Jal to the rest of their city. Until the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave them the permission to migrate to Al-Madinah. He said to As-Sahaba, when Islam started to spread in Medina, now you can go. And that was about 10 years after the birth, after the prophethood of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the age of Umm Salama at that time was about 21, 22. The mother of Salama and her husband decided to go to Al-Madinah. They were from the first few people who made this decision. Again, dangerous journey, and the danger here is Quraysh is aware that some people are trying to leave, and they said they were going to stop them. Willingly or unwillingly, you cannot leave. Abu Salama and his wife started the journey. And subhanallah, her family came and they said to the husband, where are you going? Do you think we are going to let you take our daughter to the lands, one time here and one time there? No, stop that. You didn't marry our daughter to go for adventures like this. Leave our daughter if you want to go. And he said, she's my wife. And she said, he's my husband. We need to go together. He said, no, you are our daughter and we are responsible for your safety. You can't go with this man. It's too dangerous. Then she said to her husband, the woman who was supportive and she was encouraging, she said, go and Allah will make a way for us. Go away with your religion. Protect yourself and go and Allah will make a way for us. It reminds us of Hajar, the wife of Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he came to Mecca and she said, are you going to leave us in this land? Myself and the baby? Why are you doing that? Did Allah tell you to do that? And Ibrahim said, it was an order from my Lord. She said, go. He will never let us down. And that was the beginning of the city of Mecca. Now Salama with her baby, saying something similar to her husband, go. Answer the call of Allah. Migrate in the path of Allah for the sake of Allah. And for that reason, Allah will not let us down. Allah will look after us. And once her husband left, and she was about to take her son home, the husband's family came, said, what has happened? How dare you take our son's wife from him? How can you leave our son go away without his wife? This is the family of the husband. Said, wallahi, we are going to take this child. This child belongs to us. This child is our child. He said, are you going to take a baby from the mother? He said, we don't care. We punish the man, our son, by taking his wife from him, and we are going to take our son from you. And they, Umm Salama herself reported, they started pulling the baby, the child, until they dislocated his arm, while she was screaming and crying. Can you see the level of sacrifice this woman had to go through? They took the child away, and she went with her family. And she said, I continued to go every day to the same spot and cry for nearly 1 year. 1 year, and Salama, the companion of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, was going there every day to cry. She lost her husband and her son at the same time. And she's crying, asking Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala to make a way out for her from this calamity. After nearly 1 year, as she said, a man from her husband's family saw her, and he went to his family and he said to him, don't you have any mercy in your hearts? Just hand the baby back to this woman. She's about to die. She cries every day. Just give her her child. They went and they gave the child to Salama, and once she took her son, she didn't wait. She took a camel and she left. And she said, wallahi, I had no one with me except my child. And she started to make that journey. If you went there, you know the distance between Mecca and Medina. Just outside Mecca, Uthman ibn Abi Uthman ibn Talha. So a man who was not Muslim, but he knew the dignity and the respect. And this man, by the way, he had the key of Al-Kaaba. And one time when Rasul was still in Mecca, Uthman opened Al-Kaaba for people to go in. That was the tradition. And the Rasul came to go with them as he used to do before. And he didn't want the Rasul to go in because after he became a prophet. And he was trying to stop him. And then Rasul looked calmly at him and said, Uthman, can you imagine a day when I have this key and I will be making the decision who was going to take it? He said, that day might be cursed. That day will be a day of destruction for Quraysh. And then Rasul ﷺ said that will be the day of success for Quraysh. Later, Uthman became Muslim. And the Rasul ﷺ conquered Mecca. And he went before Al-Kaaba, in front of Al-Kaaba, and he was given the key of Al-Kaaba. And he said, where is Uthman? They called Uthman, he said to him, Al-Yawma Yawm Wafa. Today I'm going to fulfill my word to you. Take this. And he said to him, this is yours, only unjust ones can take it from you. This is going to be yours forever. And until today, this family has the key of Al-Kaaba. So Uthman saw Salama. He said, where are you going? She said, I'm going to join my husband. He said to her, who's with you? He said, only Allah and my son. He said, wallahi, this cannot happen. We are not men here if we allow you to go like that. I'm going to take you. And he walked. He pulled her camel and he walked with her from Mecca until there. And she said, when we used to stop for rest, he used to go in front of me, tie the camel, turn his face away and walk away. and make like set the camel down and walk away. And then when it's time to go, he used to go and ask me to sit on the camel, and then he will give me his back and make the camel stand and then start going. She said, "Wallahi, I haven't seen anything bad from this man. He's the most generous man I've seen." And even later said, "The best man I saw is my husband Abu Salama, and the most generous man I saw is Uthman ibn Abi Uthman." When she arrived at Al-Madinah, just before Al-Madinah, "Look at this man." He said, "Can you see those houses? Your husband is there. See you later." He made a U-turn and went. He didn't even wait for someone to reward him or someone to give him any price or even to say thank you to him. He just left and went back all the way. Subhanallah. See that Rasulullah said, people are like minerals. So you have, this is silver. If you have mud on it, it's still silver inside. If you have gold and it's covered with whatever, it's still gold inside. Say people like minerals, like gold and silver. So that the best of them in al-Jahiliyyah will be the best in al-Islam. So that man was not Muslim, but he had that seed of goodness inside his heart. Salama arrived with her husband, with Salama, and then she had other children as well. She had Umar, and she had Zainab, and she had Durra. Two boys and two girls. Rasulullah ﷺ moved to Al-Madinah. Her husband fought with Rasulullah ﷺ in the Battle of Badr. And one time he came to his wife and he said to her, "I learned a very beautiful advice from Rasulullah ﷺ today." She said, "What?" He said, "Rasulullah ﷺ said that there is no Muslim affected by calamity." And he said, "O Allah, Allahumma jurni fi musibati. O Allah, reward me for my calamity. وَخْلُفْنِي خَيْرًا مِّنْهَا. And replace me with something better. Except Allah will do it." So Abu Salama said to his wife, "Our Rasul taught us this today. Any loss you make in this life, just say, Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa khulufni khayran minha. Reward me and replace me with something better." And he used to say, "Allahumma khulufni fi ahli khayra. Oh Allah, if I go, look after my family after me." In the Battle of Uhud, he was wounded. The second battle after Rasulullah ﷺ went. So if you are good in maths, so she was born 24 years before Hijrah. Alright? And then the battle of Uhud came 3 years after Hijrah. So she was about 27 years old. And he died. When Abu Salama died, Rasulullah ﷺ came to see him. When he was dead, and Salama was there. And he said to her, Salama, "Say, Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa khlufni khayran minha." The same dua that her husband taught her. "Say, oh Allah, reward me in my calamity and replace me with something better." She said, "I wanted to say it, but who's going to be better than Abu Salama? What kind of thing Allah is going to give me better than this man?" SubhanAllah. Then Rasul said, "Just say it." Then she said, "Allahumma ajurni fi musibati wa khlufni khayran minha." 4 months and 10 days later, that's after her iddah, she reported, she said, "I was sitting at home doing some work, and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked for permission." Then she said, "I prepared a place, covered herself," she said, "You're coming." And she had a cushion, she put it down, Rasul sat on it. And he proposed to her. She said, "Ya Rasulullah, I cannot refuse you, but I'm very jealous, and you have other wives. I'll cause you problems, and I cannot cause a problem for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'll be destroyed. Second, I'm an old woman now." And she said, "And I have 4 children. Then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her, "About your jealousy, Allah will remove it from you. About your children, they will be my children. With regard to age, I am old too." Then instead being The mother of Salama, she became our mother. The mother of this entire nation. The mother of the believers. The dua when she said, oh Allah, replace me with something better, Allah replaced her with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's of course far better than Abu Salama. And being the mother of Salama is not as being the mother of the believers, radiallahu ta'ala anha. So it's like Allah rewarded this woman at the end. You see that when she was young, she made that winning at the end. She was successful at the end. And she became successful because she started the journey early in her life. And she had to sacrifice. Being the wife of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wasn't fun. I mean, a lot of responsibility. But the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam favored her a lot. And as even Aisha radiallahu anha, she said she was almost the most beautiful wife of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And one time Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was sitting down with Al-Hasan on one lap and Al-Husayn on the other and Fatima in the middle. So imagine he was sitting and Hassan, Hussein and Fatima like that. And he said, Rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu alaykum ahlal bayti innahu hamidun majid. This is a verse in the Quran about the family of Ibrahim. But he said it regarding his family. He said, the mercy of Allah and his blessing upon you, the household of the Prophet. Then Umm Salama was there. She was in tears. I said, Umm Salama, what's wrong? She said, Ya Rasulullah, you made this special for them, but not for me. He said, you and your daughter, she was sitting there, her daughter Zainab, said, you and your daughter from Ahlul Bayt. You are from my household. He told them first, your children will be my children. Zainab, this daughter of Umm Salama, became one of the leaders in terms of fiqh later. She was a scholar, and the scholars used to go and learn from her. She was so close to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salama joined the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many important occasions. One of them was Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, when Rasul had a treaty with Quraysh. He was about to do Umrah, and the people of Quraysh didn't allow him in. Then he had to go back. Then he said to his companions, there's no more Umrah, we're going, shave your hair and slaughter your sacrifice. They didn't do it. They were very upset. Then he went inside and said to Umm Salama, what's this? My people have disobeyed me. Allah will destroy them. My people have disobeyed me. She said, Ya Rasulullah, do you want my advice? He said, yes. He said, don't talk. Just go outside, shave and slaughter. They will just follow you. They love you so much, but they are upset. Then Rasulullah listened to Umm Salama. He went out, he shaved and slaughter, they said that people started, all of them, one after the other, to follow Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was with Rasul Fath Makkah in the Battle of Hawaz, in the Battle of At-Taif, and other battles with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she was the last wife of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to die, in about 60 years after Hijrah. So you work out her age at that time. 60 years after Hijrah, or 60 or 61, that's when she died, and she was the last one to die from the companions of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many of the tabi'een learned from Umm Salama because she lived for long. They learned from her. So a lot of the fiqh that we study today, even tajweed in the Quran, was narrated from Umm Salama. Her hadith are in Al-Bukhari, Al-Muslim, Al-Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, Al-Nasai, Ibn Majah. They all narrated a hadith from Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha. All madhahib, Abu Hanifa, and Malik, and Ahmed, and Al-Shafi'i, and others, they all learned from Umm Salama. And they all had opinions that went back to Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha. Can you see, subhanallah, 11 or 12 years old woman started the journey at that time to be our mother today. And she will be our mother yawm al-qiyamah as well. She will be with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the Day of Judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill our hearts with the love of Umm Salama and the rest of the wives of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send our salutation to Umm Salama right now and to inform her that there are people now in this place remembering her. We ask Allah azza wa jalla to be pleased with Umm Salama and to elevate her rank in al-Jannah. and to reward her on our behalf. Allahumma inna nas'aluka ridhaka wal jannah wa na'udhu bika min sakhatika wa min an-nar. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-huda wal tuqa wal afafa wal ghina. Allahumma aati nufusana taqwaha, zakkiha anta khayru man zakkaha. Allahumma aghnina bihalalika an haramik, wa bita'atika an ma'siyatik, wa bifadlika amman siwak. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah, وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه واجعلنا من الراشدين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.
خصك الرحمن بالفضل والتيجان والروح والريحان. يا حامل القرآن قد خصك الرحمن بالفضل والتيجان.